My name is Smita Bharti. I like to think of myself as a dreamer and a seeker. I'm a theater practitioner. I wear many, many hats, but that's the most favorite hat that I have, which is of the world of theater. When I write, I act, I direct, and sometimes produce as well. But I also, like, I write for other genres also, films, web series, small ads. I'm also a trainer. I work in the development sector. I run an NGO called Sakshi and have been doing that for a few years now. These are the hats that did not come easily to me or simply to me, except the one hat, which is the theater. Theater is something that I've been doing since I was a child. You know, I was a voracious reader. I used to read a lot. And I think a theater came into my DNA when I was as young as maybe what, 6, 7, 8, that as young as that. I was studying in Shimla, and there is a place called Gaiety Theater over there where the Britishers used to perform their summer plays, you know. And then there was a cleanup that happened over there at the basement. And my uncle, who used to work over there as a volunteer, he brought home, I don't know, I mean, 50, 60, 100 books of three-act comedy plays, original plays, that the Britishers had performed in the early 1900s. And that was the fodder on which I grew up. Like, those were the books I read in my absolute formative years. So I think that kind of just came into my DNA, and that just became part of who I was and who I am. And I was making theater. I remember writing my first play when I was in grade 6. Life took many turns for me, and I had an early marriage and then long stint in that relationship, and then I finally stepped out of that relationship in 1995, which is when I really started working. Okay, I had not worked before that. In fact, it's a very interesting anecdote I have about CV as well. Like, we all know what a CV is today, right? And we kind of take great pains in making a CV. There was this whole stint in between in which the CV had to be like really heavy, like ran into 15, 20, 30 pages. You know, heavier the CV, and now it's come back to this one page. And if you can't say it in a page, it's not worth it. So it's seen its own journey. But my story and my relationship with the CV is really funny. So I had stayed in this relationship because I felt I was not professionally equipped, qualified. I had an early marriage. I'd just done my undergrad from a college in Delhi, LSR. And I had done my master's, but from communication. So how am I going to actually support myself? I have 2 children. How can I actually take them away from the comforts and, you know, expose them to a life where I won't be able to support myself, let alone my children? And I never wanted to be dependent on anybody. And then I landed up in this. So I've always been reading Jiddu Krishnamurti's books, J. Krishnamurti. And that's the kind of philosophy in which I was bringing up my children. And in 95, when I stepped out, I landed up in Chennai. And I was like, I'm right next to Rishi Valley. And that for me was like, you know, pilgrimage. Like, I have to go and sit under the banyan tree that J. Krishnamurti talks about and all. And so my mother, poor thing, she was kind of supporting, so supportive. She accompanied me. We did an overnight bus journey. We landed up in the Krishnamurti school. And I'm sitting over there and I'm looking all around and I'm walking. I was a visitor. And I was like, why can't I work here? Why can't I teach over here? I've never worked before this in my life. Right? Why can't I teach over here? Why can't I work over here? So I walk into the bursar's room and I sit over there and I say, I have a question for you. He said, I want to teach over here. So he says, have you ever taught before? I said, no. So do you have a B.Ed? I said, no. What have you studied? So I said, well, I did my thing, graduation from LSR, and I've done my master's from communication and not really too much after that. And he was like, okay, so why don't you give me your CV? And I'm like, what's a CV? That's where my journey started, really. that's where my journey started. I mean, it's a completely another story, the how the whole Krishnamurti Foundation family just adopted me, and I got a job, and I was one of the founding teachers in the new school that was coming up near Pune called Sahyadri. I taught there. Yeah, universe is a way of bringing things together. Like, there I was in this beautiful environment. My children's education, they were studying in one of the best schools in the world. I had a place to stay, a roof over my head, and doing something which was beautiful, teaching children, you know, and crafting my own curriculas. And I was just very, very clear in my head that I can do many things, but one thing that I will not do is to work for something that I don't believe in, you know. So what did I believe in? I believed in creativity. I believed in the Krishnamurti philosophy, the kind of Krishnamurti philosophy. I believed in, at that point of time, I did not have an understanding of gender rights or, you know, equality or, no, I was just, did not have that awareness. I was not woke, like even Pankaj Tripathi in the serial is saying, I'm woke. I wasn't woke or anything. I was just very unaware at that point of time. But what I did know was that this is not the life that I should have had. And I need to make sure that many people, or as many people around me, don't have to undergo the kind of experiences that I had to undergo. What is it that I can do for that? And I have no idea. So I think just because my intention was very clear, my motivation was very clear, and I just knew what I did not want to do. So the process of elimination kind of cleared the path and actually left nothing in front of me, so to speak. Like, where do I go? Because all these jobs are about this 9 to 5 in a corporate, become a trainer. So all those people, there were lots of all those options opening up because of my theater background and my ability to speak, or my ability to perform or act, you know. So training in a corporate setup would have come easy to me, or working in, you know, acquiring, or, and I had started studying. So studying for HR or PR and all those things would have come easy to me, but it was like elimination. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to go down that road. So then it was like a blank and barren landscape. Where do I really go from here? And all roads led to the development sector then, so to speak, which is how I kind of entered, and I started teaching in the Sahyadri school, but then I had to leave that school very quickly because all my court cases were in Delhi and I couldn't take so much leave. So I had to leave the school and shift to Delhi, and I joined. So I did. So what I'm trying to put out over here is that it wasn't an easy journey to be where I am today, right? I started from no qualifications to acquiring all the qualifications that I needed slowly along the way. All the work experience was because this is what I wanted to do, and that was the only way I wanted to earn my money. Teaching was something that I had started with, so I came back here to Delhi and I started teaching in Vasant Pari School. I started working in an organization called Katha, and I also became a translator and almost like an executive assistant to an academic who was working in literature, because these were the areas that I wanted to work in. I wanted to work with literature, I wanted to work with children, I wanted to work with education, you know. So those are the areas, and language and writing and translating. So those were the areas that I wanted to work in, and those were the places that I found my job, even if they were all paying me pittance, small monies, but all that money was coming. I was working very long hours, but I was growing as a person. I was growing in my head, in my exposure, in my understanding. While I was working with Katha, I would take so Katha opened up this whole world of working with people, working with communities through literature, through our Indian literature. Okay, Katha is a beautiful organization which works with short stories written in regional languages translated into English. And it does many, many other things as well. It has this beautiful community program in which an alternate way of education is something that Geeta Dharmarajan has started. So I got all that exposure. So from a J. Krishnamurti way of teaching and learning and philosophy, before the children would come in, we would be put through some kind of preparation in which, you know, we would be unraveled like a sweater. And all our minds would be cleared up, and then we would be kind of come together, put together before the children came into the residential school, so that we were free of our own angst and we were ready to receive the children with all clarity. So from that kind of a healing, cathartic environment to a place like Katha, where all these short stories and literature from all over the country were actually opening up my whole world to Sakshi, which brought in this entire understanding of what is equality, what is gender rights, what is it that we are not aware of, what is it that we are not looking at, how is it? So all of these things have come, I think, in slow progression into my life and equipped me layer by layer, sedimented and worked and opened up my whole, it just opened up the universe for me. So I think my life journey and my career journey has come together. And in hindsight, I can say, wow, what a journey. But I can promise you, when I was living through it, it was not all roses. It was pretty rough. I think 2020 has been an exceptionally important year, I mean, globally. At all levels, like at any plane that you want to think about, it has had an impact on that, whether you want to talk about it at a personal level or you want to talk about it in an economic level or you want to talk any level, any plane. It has had a huge impact because it has kind of shifted us from this whole race of consumption into actually pausing and saying, okay, you know, I mean, we can live life without consuming all the time. Okay, I really don't need 50 pairs of shoes because I really am not traveling out so much. I really don't need to catch a flight from one city to the other and leave so many carbon footprints because I can actually meet people on Zoom and it's really going to be, you know, and I'm talking the privileged space. If I go beyond that, it has had a huge impact. It's actually brought to surface all the systems that are failing us. If you look at this whole migrant issue, okay, if you look at the entire wave of what happened with the people when they had to leave their cities and go back, or where did they go back, or how many of us were really concerned about it, or what did the privileged and the underprivileged, actually the whole divide, okay, and the divide which is not really completely plugged together, right? It has been a year and it has been a time when each one of us actually at an individual level has had to pause and actually reassess and reconsider what really is fulfillment, what really is achievement, and what really is the discipline that we can bring in our lives. You know, it's about moving away from indulgence, I will because I can, to a thinking of, do I really need to? Is that really required? And can I do without? Because somebody else needs it. You know? So this whole shift from actually consumption to compassion is a possibility now. And in a very strange way, in this extremely disconnected year, people have really connected, not only with themselves, but with also each other in ways that we've never had the time before. We've just been so busy racing. I have seen people coming together, but I've also seen fear and paranoia stepping in as well, you know, and we're making it easier for people to drive the other person away. So it has actually seen both the things surfacing. So I wouldn't say it's just brought the people together, because fear is the one that actually keeps people away. And fear is the one which actually creates the rifts, and it's very easy to fuel fear, especially when the virus is invisible and we don't know where to blame it. So either we want to be in complete denial or we want to be in complete paranoia, but we don't really understand. So there is a absence of understanding on how to deal with this world which is emerging now. We don't know. It's almost like learning to walk again. We don't know how to walk. So we are all these adults, but we really don't know how to walk or how to learn. And it's the symbols are the same, the processes are the same, the images are the same, but the meanings have changed. The relationships have changed, and we don't know yet what that all is, and how do we relate to it, or how do we respond to it. Everybody is very tentative about it, you know. So I wouldn't say that it has necessarily brought people together. It has brought people together in clusters, where they cluster together out of fear or paranoia, or they cluster together in denial. So it's kind of different kind of clustering which is taking place. We really don't know what that is right now. What is theater? Theater brings together creative people who take a slice of life and put it together in a framework and ascribe a meaning to it, or open up layers and nuances and put it out there for the people to view and assimilate, and either say, oh yeah, this is exactly what's happening in my life, or to say, wonder, oh my God, can this also happen, right? But this is all about creativity coming together, right? So if creativity, and what is creativity? Creativity is addressing and looking at a situation and a solution and coming up with an innovative response to it. So yes, while I shouldn't make light of the all the artists and all the craftsmen and cultural industry workers whose livelihoods have been impacted by the closing down of the physical spaces of theater, of closing down of the physical theaters per se, and the physical plays coming to a stop. But theater hasn't stopped. They have just shifted online. They have just started looking at, okay, so if this is the medium, then if this is the medium I have to work with, and if the screen is my stage now, how am I going to be using this screen to do a live performance for you? You know? So yes, on one hand, we have all these performers, folk artists, the physical theater space, the production designers, the stage craft people, all these people whose livelihoods have been very, very severely impacted. And we do not know really when it's going to pick up, you know, from the street performers to the theater performers, and when it's really going to come back again, because this is not in our hands, it's in the hand of this little tiny invisible virus which is deciding to mutate and stay one step ahead of us all the time. But then there are others who are actually saying, okay, what can be the innovative solutions of moving? Because life is like water, it keeps flowing, and we have to keep swimming in it like fish all the time and finding out our own innovative spaces and niches in it. So many people have started experimenting with Zoom theater, as they call it, which is online performances, using the screen. In fact, I just attended an international theater festival where we had plays from, I don't know how many countries, I think about 30 countries had participated, and about 30 countries had participated in that, and there were plays from Brazil to Ireland to Wales to US to Argentina to Iran to India, you know, on people who are experimenting with the screen and saying, how can we shift from a physical theater space onto making this little screen over here into a performance stage, which is not film, which is not something which is already recorded and then streamed later, which is happening right there and then. Like, people are performing there and then and interacting, and all the actors are in different spaces, right? So it's not as if you're in the same physical space, but responding to each other, talking to each other, performing with each other. Brilliant. I think conviction is really necessary and Conviction, if you have conviction, then many of the obstacles just fade away in front of it, right? When you lose conviction in whatever it is that you're doing or you want to do or you're seeking to do, then it's impossible to even move forward a single step, right? So I think my conviction in the world that I wanted to see, in the world that I want to see still, it's not as if I've achieved it or realized it, but my conviction that it is possible, my conviction that it can happen is actually what keeps me going. And the second thing that I think I had with me was hard work. I wasn't scared of working hard. I wasn't scared of just putting my 100% in whatever it is that I was doing. I just had to do it, and I had to do it the best way I can. I possibly can, right? And if I didn't know, then, and I wasn't scared to say, I don't know. I wasn't scared to accept that I don't know, but I will get to know. So I don't know, that disclosure was not my ending point. That was my starting point. That, okay, I don't know how to do this. Like when I produced my first film, somebody came to me and said, do you want to produce a film? And I'm like, I don't even know what a camera looks like. You know, how do you expect me to do that? He says, no, because you're great at organizing and you're structuring and you're thinking and your enrollment and the way you talk to people and you understand aesthetics. So he gave me a long list of, you know, whatever competencies he thought I already had. And I said, okay. I said, yes, I'll do it. And I didn't know, but I got to know. I learned how to do it. Okay. And I did become the executive producer of this feature film, and it did get big. And, you know, so I think hard work, conviction, and not being afraid to say, I don't know, and then getting to know. I think these are the three things which have really enabled me to reach and do and achieve and accomplish whatever I have managed to do that, because I wasn't dishonest to what I was doing. I didn't pretend, and I didn't give up. And I think that will probably be one part of the messaging that I would probably have for the young professionals who are there. And the second part of it was, we lived more in a men's world than you live today. Today you live in a more homogeneous world, at least on the surface of it. At least because of the policies and the laws and everything that it does exist now, at the surface of it. At an attitudinal level, the differences and the gaps still exist, just as it existed 20 years ago, 30 years ago. Right? And at that point of time, if I'm just going back to the world that I inhabited and I lived in and I grew from, which is more of a men's world, and having to work doubly hard to carve your space in it and to be acknowledged for the work that you're doing and not because you're able to do it because you're a woman. That means underlying current being that you're able to do it because you're getting special preference to do it, or you're somebody's opening up more doors for you because you happen to be pretty, or you happen to be a woman, or you just happen to be the other gender, okay? And or you happen to be like this unique position you have of being just, you know, one of the minorities there, so everybody else is going to be ignored because you have to be given a position over there because we need to be to showcase you and stuff. That is not necessarily the world here today. But one of the things that kept over there is not giving up again, not giving in, okay? Not being in a accommodative or compromising place, or not underplaying yourself, not holding back your light. Like we say, that very often we get scared of our own light and we pull back, you know? So that we don't shine brightly enough, but not doing that, like shining as brightly as you can wherever you are, and letting that light actually permeate all these gaps and crevices which are there, which create this distance in the attitude more today than it was at that point of time. But today it's more at an attitudinal level than at a surface level. But if you stay convinced about what you bring to the table and shine brightly, I think that's the holding method. Because building trust is very difficult. And I think your relationship with anybody is as, and I read this somewhere that the relationship moves at the speed of trust, you know? And I think that is also a very, very important thing that we must remember about this. And I'll tell you a small, so I, for about 8 years or so, I work inside a prison. I would go there inside as a storyteller, right? I would take these short stories and I would go inside and I would tell stories. I worked in the women's prison. I worked with the adolescents' prison. So I kind of, and when I went in there initially, these women would ask me, you know, they're asking, are you a lawyer? And I'm like, no. So they said, are you somebody from the orphanage? You know, who's going to take care of our children or tell us where the children are going to be? No, are you legal aid? No, are you? So they would ask me all the questions about are you this, that, or the other, about being somebody from the system who's actually going to make their life better. And then in the end, they would ask me, so, but who are you then? What are you? And I'd say, I'm a storyteller. And they'd show me the middle finger and say, you know, get lost. We don't, stronger terms for get lost. We don't want to have anything to do with you. But I persisted. I would land up every time. I would be there regularly, you know. So in the end, then they just saw me around and then they said, then they wanted to test me out. This is hamari wali roti khaoge. Okay. So I said, haan, hamara wala paani piyoge. I said, haan, jahan jis kambal pe hum baithte, us kambal pe baithoge. So slowly they started testing me about whether I would be that or I would be this really guest of the superintendent who would have the special privileges of eating or drinking special filtered water. I'm talking about 90s, late 90s, early 2000, right? And slowly they gave me their trust. It took a very long time, but slowly they gave me their trust before I actually could start working with them, right? So gaining trust, building trust, and then keeping that trust. I think that's one of the most important things in any relationship, whether it is professional or personal. I mean, I think that should be a very important message, especially today, as we step into the new year.